and welcome to this episode of the Warhammer Community Podcast. I am still Wade Price. I'm delighted to be joined today by the great and powerful Nick Bayton to talk all about Khagra's Ravagers. Welcome, Nick.
Welcome indeed. Great to be here, Wade, as always. Glad to see you are still Wade Price and that the cloning technology hasn't failed us. Yeah, really good to be here, man. I can't wait to talk about this warband. I've taken a deep dive in this week into Warhammer Underworlds. And yeah, let's get started, man. Let's do this.
So blessed to be chatting to you today about them, because you've already painted them at the point at which we're recording this. They're not currently available to be in people's hands, and yet you have received some sort of gift of the gods, a gift of the gods. So you've already got them painted. We can talk about the painting experience, but we've also had, yeah, as you say, a deep dive into the cards and the warbands. And we've already recorded an episode of the Warhammer Community Podcast all about the new season of Warhammer Underworld's Direchasm, so we can reference that if there's any of the new features and stuff that we've already chatted about in the new set. I'm sure that'll come up. But please speak, tell me tidings of the Dark Gods. Who are Khagra's Ravagers?
Oh, first of all, Khagra's Ravagers is the first expansion box to come in the new season of Warhammer Underworld's Direchasm. So we saw the main core set that came recently that had the Dread Pageant and Maieri's Purifiers. And now we've got an expansion box for Khagra's Ravagers, a new warband, which comes with it new miniatures, all the rules for those miniatures and the cards for those miniatures, as well as a bunch of universal cards that everybody can use in the game. So no matter what warband you've got in the game or which warband you enjoy playing with, this box set is a great one to get involved in. So what we're going to do, Wade, is we're going to go through a few things. I've written like a massive document of death. So I'm trying to go through it because I just put all my thoughts down on the digital paper. I'm going to go through sort of a few things here and there which define what the warband are, how they work in the game, some cards that are really good for them that turn up in the expansion, as well as how we can also use the cards in the expansion for other warbands as well. So should we start? Should we do this?
The first thing I wanted to observe, the only thing that I can really contribute without a set of the cards in my hands of my own, regarding the miniatures, a mean-looking crew. I think it was observed when we first saw them revealed in the Warhammer preview online. Adam and Eddie took a look and, you know, Nick, venerable greybeard hobbyists like ourselves, recognised certain aspects that we'd maybe seen before in some classic Chaos Champions in some of these figures. And even before we get into what they do in the Warhammer Underworlds game, the beautiful miniatures. We just checked in on some of the classic references that we may have seen reflected in some of their personages, a couple of Games Day special edition Chaos Champions. Did you recognise those?
No, do you know what, Wade? For my shame, and it wasn't until you mentioned it, we had a hangout in Hobby recently, and you sort of mentioned it, that the light bulb went on. I went, oh, of course they are. You're right. Go through them. You've written down a few of what they remind you of.
So they're obviously wonderful Citadel miniatures, Chaos, Slaves to Darkness, Chaos Warriors of the Mortal Realms with their own unique identities. But there are a few things that I think people have recognised or clocked. And the pose of Khagra the Usurper, the warband leader herself, looks a little bit like what was the Games Day 2009 Exalted Chaos Champion, who was, I think, sculpted by Martin Foote. It's a wonderful fluted helmet with horns curving forwards, gesturing forward with a weapon and a shield on the back. So not quite the same armament, but just like a similar sort of silhouette and similar aspect, the similar sibilant whispers of demons in the ear. And Zarshia Bittersoul, the sorcerer, looks not unlike the Games Day 2010 Chaos Sorcerer, who was more male than Zarshia is herself. And then other aspects people have recognised, I think Slambo was that classic Chaos Champion miniature with two axes that's not unlike the old Hero Quest Chaos Warrior that we'd referenced, but Yoram Dower Cregan is a little bit more well-armed for the Mortal Realms. So absolutely unique characters with their own names and abilities that we'll dive into, but yeah, just a little nod of their head to some classic Citadel miniatures and making them available in plastic as part of this warband. It's a beautiful thing to see.
But that's right. Also, I got as a strong Krom the Conqueror vibes from Ravager as well, Khagra the Usurper. It's nice. It's great. We're harking back to sort of the classic Chaos Warriors from ages past, which is just wonderful to see. And definitely, yes, I'm a nostalgia button.
Razek Godblessed, who has his axe and shield. I'm going to be getting these bits for my bits box and probably another set for the cards and all the bits to play the game with them. But that pose is reminiscent of a classic Chaos Lord or Chaos Champion that Jez Goodwin has sculpted with the two axes. That left foot raised up on a skull or a heroic rock, that is a fine pose of the Chaos Gods, and also a Champion of Khorne skull head in a similar sort of pose. Wonderful poses, very, like, the silhouettes are very striking and let you know straight away, Slaves to Darkness, Chaos Warriors, here to reave and burn. But what do they do in Warhammer Underworlds, Nick?
What don't they do, Wade? First of all, who are they? So in the background of the game, they are a warband led by Khagra the Usurper, the leader of the warband, who has wrestled power from her sister, Zasha Bittersoul, who is upset about the fact that she's had power taken from her. But they're here in the underworlds to desecrate all before them in the name of the Dark Gods, is the idea. They're basically the Chaos Worshippers here to just destroy all and desecrate the land around them, much like the Chaos Forces do in just about every game we see them in. But who are they in the game? How do they work? Let's get into that. So there's a low model count in this warband for a start, Wade, so which means they're a kind of elite warband. They're in the same sort of layer as like McGore's Fiends or the Wormspat, that kind of area, or Iron Skulls Boys as well. So low movement across the board. They've only movement 3 to start with. That does get better when they inspire. But a consistent damage output amongst the fighters means that they're going to be putting out damage all the time. It's not the highest damage in the game. They can put it out consistently and accurately, no problems at all. I've written here they have a nice balance of offensive and defensive capabilities, which is unusual from an elite warband like this. Usually they're all very hitty, like McGore's Fiends, or quite defensive, like the Wormspat. But these guys can do kind of both. You can inspire the fighters to increase movement and some damage output. But the big thing about these guys is the warband focuses around desecration tokens, how you choose to use them, and with each fighter interacting with them in different ways. Now, we're going to come to how the desecration thing works. It's the big thing about this warband that makes them unique and exciting. So we'll come to that shortly. But let's just take a quick look at the individual fighters as well. Now, in Warhammer Underworlds, if you're not aware, your warband is preset for you by the game, basically. So you have to take these 4 fighters in the warband. So where the personalization comes is with the cards and how you build your deck later on. Let's go through the 4 fighters that come with this warband. Now, starting off, let's start with the leader herself, Khagra the Usurper. Very killy, I've written here, and she really is. She starts off with a damage 3, knockback 1 weapon. She's Oberon the Bold, basically, with her weapon. Same accuracy as well. Which is a massive hit to have on someone uninspired. She has 3 movement, 1 shield for defense, and 4 wounds. And when she inspires, the defense goes up and the movement goes up, which is okay. It's okay. It still doesn't affect her killing ability, which is really what she's there for. Now, she's also got a special rule called Sacrifice, which is how she interacts with the desecration mechanic. But I'm going to come on to that later on. No, we're going to concentrate on the fighters as their fighters for now. Zasha Bittersoul, her sister, is one of the most interesting wizards in the game. She is a level 2 wizard and has 3 wounds, so not the toughest wizard at all. 3 movement, again, not that fast either. But her Spike Tongue Curse magic spell attack is super accurate because it hits on channels, which is the lightning mark, rather than focus, which is the swirly mark. Just about every other wizard in the game with a sort of ranged magic attack like this, I'm thinking of Fulmination from Stormsire, Bolt of Change from Vorsemith the All-Seeing, Stream of Corruption from Fecula, all hit on focus rather than channel. There's on the dice, there's 3 channel marks, there's 2 focus marks and 1 crit mark. So it's a higher chance of you hitting with a channel. But the downside being of this, being if this attack action fails at all ever, then Zasha suffers backlash and takes damage. So you're paying off for the fact you've got a more accurate attack on your range there with the fact that if you fail it, the Dark Gods curse you and you take a damage. But when she inspires, she goes up to having 2 damage on the magical range attack, which is great. Having such an accurate attack at 3 range, 2 damage is super good. It's probably the best inspiration upgrade in the warband. And yeah, we'll concentrate on that more later on. Up next, Dower Cragen, who is the one you mentioned looks a little bit like Slambo. He's got his sword and his axe out. Quite a reliable fighter. Less accurate than other fighters with fury-based attacks. He hits on swords rather than hammers, or fury rather than smash, and does 2 damage. Pretty good. He inspires to get +1 move, which is great, and gets cleave on his weapons as well, which is quite important in the current meta. Current meta is quite elite based, full of people governing shields, so that's good to have cleave on there. And last but not least, Razeg, God Blessed, is an accurate, consistent fighter. Damage output is high as well. He's got, when he inspires, he gets plus one move to move four, plus one shield on his defense as well. So he goes to two shields in defense. And his Hellforge adapt goes to three smash, two damage, which is pretty good. Very accurate attacks, consistent, nice. A pretty standard elite war. And they're not too different from, say, Gartog and Zartek from the Magor's Fiends warband. So how do they inspire? Well, the warband inspires if at any point after any activation of your after any activation of either your miniatures or the opponent's miniatures, there are three or more desecration tokens on the battlefield. Remember that. It's important because I'm about to talk about more. There we go. That's how they work in the game. So they're quite hitty. Khagra is very hitty. Zarsha's magic is incredibly good. And the two support fighters, Dour Kragan and Razak Goblest, are sort of great backup fighters and pretty pretty solid as well.
As a big fan of Chaos and Chaos Warbands in general, seeing the different devotees of the Dark Gods that are rocking around in Warhammer Underworlds, I do like seeing the different makeups of the Warbands, because they say Magor's Fiends, there's four models in Magor's Fiends, no wizards in Magor's Fiends, and one of them's a Fleshhound, who's a bit faster, maybe a bit more lightweight. That's kind of the prism through which I tend to see most of the Warhammer hobby through the Khorne Warbands. Also, Garrick's Reavers, more lightly armoured, more of them. Also, no wizards. But then we've seen, as you mentioned, the lovely Wormspat and Fecula. That's a smaller group of tougher armored fighters, including a wizard. So to get that balance of fighty things, magic-y things, and having stuff that you can sacrifice, there must be something that stuff's going to die in a game of Warhammer Underworlds. And these elite warbands always makes me wonder, who is it likely to be first? And how would that feature as part of the Dark God's plan? But I'm sure you've got all that worked out. You've seen.
I reckon. I've had a jolly good read this week. So you've mentioned Magor's Fiends there, where I think they're probably the warband that's closest to draw a parallel to here, being obviously worshippers of chaos and holding big axes and being chaos warriors. The blood warriors of the Magor's Fiends are all about killing, and there's nothing else that they're all about. And you can make this warband into that if you want to, but there's a special new mechanic for this warband, particularly. It's called desecration. And it's been introduced. And I think it's probably, I've mentioned it three times. Should we go through what it is?
Tell me of desecration.
You get a little card with this pack that you can keep for reference in your book. And it says this on top of it. When a rule tells you to desecrate an objective, place one friendly desecration token on that objective. So a little bead or token you got with the token set. At the end of a power step, an enemy fighter in the same hex as an objective that has a desecration token, remove that token. So if the end of a power step, an enemy has made it onto that objective that your desecration token is on, take the desecration token away. Fighters cannot hold an objective that has a desecration token. That's important. You cannot desecrate an objective that has a desecration token. Also important. If a desecration token is on an objective token that moves, the desecration token moves with it. And if a desecration token is on an objective token that's flipped, remove the desecration token. I just said the words desecration token 1,000 times. So what does it all mean? Okay, so this is important. In short, it will stop warbands looking to score surgery objectives based on holding objectives. As scoring those objectives is done immediately after an activation, your enemy will not have a chance to remove the desecration token until the end of the power step, if that makes sense. In a game of Warhammer Underworlds, each action phase is made up of four activations followed by four power steps. If it was my turn, Wade, I'd have an activation followed by a power step. If it was your turn, you'd have an activation followed by a power step. And the desecration token won't be removed until the end of your power step. So you'll, at the point in which your cards, that your surge cards, where if you hold three objectives, score X, come into play, that desecration token's still there, which means you can't hold that objective, which is great. What it does is it's going to slow people down. Of course, what you're going to do is you're going to remove that desecration token in your power step, and you'll probably get that objective next turn, but you didn't get it this turn, and that's important. There's objectives like temporary victory, hidden purpose, and swift capture are the three big ones that we've looked at so far. That they're all deal with after an activation, if your model holds X number of objectives, score immediately. They're all surge objectives, basically, those ones. So it will slow them down for a turn, basically, and just irritate people, which is perfect. If you can get your opponent off that objective in the power phase before it was due to disappear, so for example, the situation we just had there, for example, you're stood on an objective that's got a desecration token. You're going to score supremacy, say, later on, and you're desperate to score it now. And you're going to remove that desecration token. Well, if I've got push cards in my deck, like Nightmare in the Shadows, Distraction, or there's a new card called Desecrated Gauntlets, which is an upgrade for this warband, where you can push adjacent fighters around. And there's also a spell called Whispers of Chaos, which pushes enemies' fighters around. If I can push you off that objective, not only will you not score supremacy now, but you're going to have to get rid of that desecration token next turn as well. So it gives me an opportunity to just really irritate you by moving you around and stopping you holding the objectives when I want you to, which is great. You can also deny the opponent the primacy token. The primacy token is a new mechanic that came in with Direchasm, of course. And you get, if you hold the primacy token in an end phase, you get a glory point. And you can get the primacy token by holding four objectives at the end of an activation. Well, of course, if the desecration tokens are there, you don't get that. And it also means that being on guard is super useful to avoid being pushed back off objectives. This is for Khagra herself, her warband. If you just walk up to an objective and you desecrated it, and you can stand on it and stop someone moving onto the objective to clear it of the desecration token. So being on guard, cards like Grudging Defense, which is a faction upgrade where your fighter's just on guard, is wonderful. Ultimately, Wade, this means that this warband is fantastic against warbands who are desperate to capture objectives. So we've got warbands like the Grimwatch that have caused problems in events because for being super good at doing this are perfect. This warbands like Zarbag's Gits, who you'd expect to be capturing objectives a lot, are going to have problems here. So that's what desecration tokens do. You put them on an objective. The opponent can't hold that objective until they clear that objective, which they do at the end of a power step. I hope that makes sense so far.
It does, yeah.
Good. But the important thing is, how do you actually get those tokens down? Because it's not just an automatic thing. And there's a few ways that Khagra's Ravagers have a chance to do this. Okay, so the first one is on Khagra herself. Her card has the sacrifice rule. It's a reaction. So here's how it works. And this also applies to every single member of the warband. So it's the rules on her card, but every member of the warband does this. After an activation in which this fighter's attack action includes magical attack actions, of course, takes the target out of action, desecrates one objective in the same same hex as the fighter or the target. So what you're looking to do here is you want to attack either enemies on an objective marker or from an objective marker. You want to be able to hitting someone who was on one, in which case they fall over, they die, you put desecration token on the objective marker, or you charge onto an objective marker, kill someone next to it, and then put the desecration marker down. So something that came to my mind straight away is, how will this affect objective placement when you're setting them up in the game? Mm-hmm. Will you be planning to put those objectives, for example, Khagra is movement 3 with the damage of 3. So if you put one of those objective tokens 3 hexes away from one of your starting hexes, you'll be charging straight onto the objective token. You'll be smashing someone's face in if they're foolish enough to stand next, starting hex next to that objective token, and immediately putting a desecration token down. So it's going to really make you think about how you place those objectives. With a small number of fighters as well, there's a high chance of you going first, which really helps out what I just talked about. Also, something to consider here is the super reliable range attack from Zarsha, who's got the range magical attack. If you can run onto an objective and zap someone 3 hexes away and take them out of action, that's a good way of doing it as well. So that's that sacrifice. That works for all 4 members of the warband. Kill someone on objective or from an objective, desecrate that objective. Second of all, we've got the despoil rule, which is unique to Dao Kragan and Radek Gobless. These are the 2 support fighters of the warband, and actually makes them quite reliable here. If the fighter holds an objective at the end of an action phase, the action phase being once both players have had all 4 turns, 4 activations and 4 power phases are done, at the end of that action phase, desecrate that objective if they're holding the objective. So if they stood on an objective at the end of the turn, put a desecration token down on it, which is pretty cool. It won't be as often as sacrifice because, of course, it only happens once at the end of every action phase. But I've got a cheeky combination here. Combined with the Mask of Darkness, which is a spell which you can cast and moves a fighter from your territory onto any objective, which you can do in the last power step of any phase for a bit of extra fun. But they're quite good at sort of just holding, sitting on an objective, holding it, despoiling it, and guarding it. Good shout. And the last way you can discreate objectives is to use gambit ploys. There are some gambit ploys that allow you to do this. Rack the Land and Ritual Desecration, both available to gain desecration tokens reliably. You don't need to roll dice for those. You don't have to kill someone for it. You haven't got to hold an objective. You just literally go, play the card, desecrate that objective within a certain range. Ritual Desecration is incredible as well because it also inspires your fighter that you play on as well. So you play that card on a fighter, they desecrate an objective they're stood on, and they inspire, which is so good. There's been other cards in the game before, Inspiration Strikes, that just inspire your fighter, but this one does that as well as desecrating objectives, so it's super good. So there we go. That's how you get the tokens down. That's what desecration is, and we're probably going to talk about it a lot throughout. That's a lot of me talking. Apologies, but okay, that's it. But
And did you say with three or more desecration tokens on the board, that's when the entire warband inspires?
That's right, yeah. Now, it's a tough thing to do, Wade, because actually clearing desecration tokens from objectives is again, quite easy to do if you want to do that. For some warbands who are concentrating on holding objectives, it'll be great because I want to be on those objectives. Other warbands, we'll get into this later on, but other warbands may not have actually wanted to get onto objectives in the first place, so they might be ignoring them, but they now might find a reason to go onto them, and you might be able to influence the way that they move in that way. It's a difficult thing to get them to inspire, because having three down on the table at once is hard. You'll need to get three kills and sacrifice objectives, or you'll need to get Dauran and Kragan and Razak, God bless, to stand on objectives and hold them, or you'll need a lucky turn, I think, to get three desecration tokens off. I think I've not played with them yet, but I think a lucky turn. Having said that, the benefits they gain from inspiration, it's not the be all and end all. So if you spent the entire game with them uninspired, it's okay. The and we'll come on to which ones we'd inspire with desecration later, or that ritual desecration later on. But they're still pretty tasty even when they're not inspired.
Okay, so we've got a phenomenal overview of the warband fighters and the mechanic that makes this warband unique. So with all of that in mind, in Warhammer Underworld's language, what kind of warband are Khagra's Ravagers?
Yeah, so we talk about lots of different types of warband, and they are a aggro / control flex warband. So flex means they do two different things at once. They are aggressive and controlling. Aggressive basically means they go and hit people on the head with big axes, and they're very good at doing that. Control means they control the battlefield in such a way that and try and deny the opponent certain things, or control the opponent's ability to do certain things. Very obviously, that's the desecration technique. They're going to try and stop you holding those objectives and scoring those surge victories if they possibly can. That's what you want. So if you want a pure aggro warband, I mean, both, they can be designed to be both. If you want to go pure hit people on the head with axes, you can do that. If you want to go all about desecrating, I think you can do that too. But I think it's really important to state that they're probably best when you combine the two together.
Well, desecrating sounds great, and inspiring sounds great as well, but that isn't how you win games of Warhammer Underworld, is it? So how do you expect to be approaching playing the game with Khagra's Ravagers and scoring glory?
So what I think you need to do with these guys is you need to try and combine the two, as I said. So you want to try and get the desecration tokens down, because there's a few objectives that are based on that. But also, you're not going to get those desecration tokens down unless you can kill something, because that's the best way of doing it. Let's have a look at the two different ways of playing. So I've written down here unbelievably extensive list of cards that are great for both the aggro side and also for the control side, which we'll go through later on. Now let's look at aggro first of all, and we're going to look at the faction cards that come in the actual expansion itself. So faction cards, each faction always comes with cards that are unique to that faction. Only Khagra's Ravagers can use them, and there's also universal cards too. Let's have a look at those faction cards first of all. Up first, I'm going to my picks for best things for aggro: Power of Chaos, Surge. It's a Surge, so you score immediately. Kill an enemy with a spell for one glory. Great. You can do that quite easily once you've inspired Zarshia Bittersoul. Secondly, we've got Hurricane of Violence. What a name that is. Score an end phase. Two enemy fighters are dead in the one phase for two glory. Now, against some other warbands like the Wurmspat or any of the Stormcast Eternals, that'd be a problem. But if you're playing Zarbag's Gits, Sepulchral Guard, great. You can kill two guys in one phase, no problem at all. There's a card called Dark.
I'm reading along with you, because all of the cards were presented up on the Warhammer community website. So if anyone's interested, peeped and thought, I'd quite like to see some of these cards as well, they're all available to be accessed in the Warband Focus article. Sorry, Nick, carry on.
That's all right. No, that's where I was reading them from as well. Next up, there's a card called Dark Approval, which is, have you ever heard of a card called Victorious Duel? It's the same, but it's a faction specific, where if your leader kills your enemy leader, you gain two glories, an automatic surge kill, which is, again, great. Because with very few upgrades, you can get Khagra up to doing the magic 4 damage, which is what you want to try and aim for. And she can be hitting any leader out of the park, no problem at all, especially if they're smaller, like, say, one of the goblins or Vortimus the All-Seeing or that sort of thing. So those are great for killing stuff. If you just want to kill stuff, let's look at some of the Gambit ploys from this expansion as well. Eternal Vendetta lets you reroll one attack dice next activation. Always useful for when you get things wrong. Also good that you can, I believe it counts, works on a spell attack action as well. But I'm not sure if it does. I'll have to reread that in a second. If it does, that makes the spell even more accurate and stops the backlash. Eye of the Gods, when enemy leader is dead, choose. When the enemy leader is dead, your leader can choose either plus one dice, plus one damage, cleave, or ensnare, and it's permanent until she dies, which is amazing. So good. And also later on comes into play with Power Reclaimed, which we'll talk about in a second. But I think for me, that's an automatic take. If you can have an automatic plus one dice or an automatic plus one damage when you've killed the enemy leader, you're in. There's a card called Spurred On, another Gambit ploy. Any lead after leader's move action, another friendly fighter makes a move action. Great. And that also counts as a super action as well. So if you make a charge action, you can make a move action alongside. Lovely, much like the Scurry from the Zarbag's kits. Ritual Desecration, we've talked about that already. Desecrate an objective and inspire a fighter. And I think for me, the two candidates here, probably either Khagra to inspire her early on to make a super, super killy and super defensive, or more likely Zasha, the wizard, who getting up to that two damage on the spell is wonderful. Card called Ravaging Advance, another ploy. Push each friendly fighter in your territory or no man's land one hex towards enemy. Great. It's a free push. Very few cards push four fighters at once. And this one does, which is superb. That's a great card to turn. If you turn up in turn one and you get that in your hand, you're like, winner. Power Reclaimed. We'd mentioned this earlier on. This is a great... plays on the idea that Zasha is super bitter about the fact that her sister's taking control of the warband. If Khagra, the usurper, is dead, play this card to give Zasha plus one wizard level. Level three wizard, the second time you've seen it in the game after Khagra. Exciting. And plus one wounds. Plus one wizard level, and plus she becomes level three wizard at four wounds, and at that point she's better than Stormsire at casting her magic spell, which is incredible.
Silver lining if Khagra happens to fall, or is that a reason to?
Yeah. So I think if you there's two ways of playing this. You can either rely on Khagra dying early on and build your desk around that. Just send her in, get her killed. Zasha takes over and loves it. And then that wizard becomes an absolute nightmare of just like a machine gun in the middle of the table, just gunning people down. Much like Stormsire did before some of the cards got rotated out. Alternatively, you can build a deck around Khagra being amazing and going in and having the support from Kasha, but from Zasha. I really do think Zasha's the best candidate for inspiration here, if you've only got one to inspire. Okay, there's one more Gambit ploy here called Mask of Darkness, which is a really cool card, much like the old Fameway Crystal of old before they got rotated out, where you can choose one friendly fighter, and move them onto an enemy objective, which is great in enemy territory. So you just literally move them straight on there. And imagine doing that at the very, very last power phase of a turn. You just move Dalkragan or Razek onto an enemy objective and just desecrate it straight away. Amazing. And if that was your third desecration token that's on the table and they all inspire, absolute winner. Okay, if you're feeling aggressive and you want to use some upgrades that come in the set as well, let's have a look at some of the faction-specific upgrades. I love the Hellfire Sword. It's a new magic weapon that's come with this expansion just for Khagra's Ravagers, this one. It's range 3, damage 2, dice 2. But it is restricted to either Khagra or Razek. Now, Khagra has a damage 3 weapon anyway, rather than damage 2, which is what this Hellfire Sword is. So it's quite good for her to get a ranged attack, but it's even better if you can put it on Razek, whose attacks are only damage 2 normally. Basically, it makes him up to damage range 3 on his attacks, which is amazingly good. All of a sudden, you've got two Zashas firing off magic attacks all over the place. And something I thought as I was writing this, can you kill someone? Can you stand on an objective, right, with Razeg? Can you kill someone who was 3 hexes away on another objective, okay, with the Hellfire Sword, and then despoil the objective you're stood on at the end? So can you desecrate 2 objective tokens in one turn with one guy? You probably can. It's not going to happen very often, but I just want to know, again, but it might make you think about where you're going to place those objective tokens, because you can't place one within 2 hexes, but you can place one 3 hexes away from each other at the start. Maybe you'll think about it like that. But if anyone ever does that, please let me know. I want to find out. Up next, there's an upgrade called Ruinous Might. Just plus 1 damage to your attacks. Great. Get Khagra's attacks to that magical meta-busting damage 4, I've written it. kill big enemies, gets more chance of scoring Dark Approval. Yep. If you can get your attacks to damage 4, you're killing all Stormcast, Wormspat, Magor's Fiends, in one hit, which is really what you want to go for. Not only does that get you the primacy token, which is for killing a model that had no wounds and immediately killing it dead in one hit, but also your kill threshold goes from two attacks down to one attack. You don't want to be hitting Stormsire twice. If you can do them in one hit, perfect. That's amazing. Up next, we've got Gifted Sorcerer, which I love. This is a kind of restricted disaster, naturally. But reroll one dice on casting rolls and spell attack actions. I've written auto take here. Yes, absolutely. Because if she suffers backlash and takes damage from it, it's not great. She's only got three wounds. So you want to make her attacks more reliable. Gifted Sorcerer is a great upgrade for doing just that. There's an upgrade called Conqueror's Cloak, again, faction specific. Plus two move on charge actions. All of a sudden, you've got a potentially movement six Khagra the Usurper. Deal with that. That's so good. Only on charge actions, though, not all the time. But that's such a good card.
Yeah, I like the way earlier on in the show you were suggesting that, you know, people might have to think about placement of objectives now that you've got the opportunity of these Chaos Warriors surging up. Okay, well, we'll just back away a hex or two. And then just be reminded, no, if the Gods of Chaos bless them at the appropriate time, they will be on you like a flesh hound and there'll be nothing you can do about it. Good time.
And last but not least, I've got here another great faction-specific card for aggressive style play is Bolstered by Hate, plus one wound. It's basically a faction-specific great fortitude. And I've written, nobody likes trying to fight five wound models. You're not wrong.
Tooled up for the meta busting damage four.
That's it. Because if you're imagining everyone else is trying to get to damage four, you get to wounds five, and all of a sudden you're in a two hit threshold, which is perfect. Also, combined with great fortitude to make her six wounds, which is amazing. The downside being, of course, if she's killed, is now worth two glory in Direchasm. Okay, so let's have a look at some universal cards. I'm going to run through these. I didn't realize how long it's going to take, but I'm loving this. Sorry, man. Let's have a look at some objectives. If you're feeling fighty and aggressive and you want to use Khagra's Ravagers, let's have a look at some objective cards you want to use here. First of all, Conquest. It's a classic. We've seen it from Shadespire all the way through. In the third end phase, if all your friendly surviving fighters are in enemy territory, gain two glory points. Yeah, always a good card to go for. They're not very fast, but by the third end phase, they'll get there as well, especially if you're trying to desecrate objectives that are in the enemy territory. There's a card called Run Ragged, which is end phase. Each surviving fighter has a move or charge token. Yeah, you're probably going to do that. You've got four fighters you can use, which is great for activation efficiency. You get one activation per fighter, which is wonderful. Yeah, there's no sort of, you're not left with that sort of three fighter warband. They've all charged. What do I do now? Draw a power card, I guess. But the fact they're all gonna move, they're all gonna charge at some point. So for two glory, I'll take that. Up next, Arcane Expertise, Surge, kill precise with a spell. What I mean by precise is that it does the exact damage you needed to kill a fighter. That's great for Khagra's not quite been upgraded yet. She runs in, slaps, Stormsire on the head for three damage. He's looking pretty ill, and then Zarcha just comes up and zaps him for one with her spiked tongue curse. And perfect for one glory. I'll take that as well, Serge. Lovely. Victorious Duel, same as we said before. Your leader kills an enemy leader for two glory points. Great. You're going to. I mean, there's very few leaders in the game. I mean, Molug and Morgok aside, you're probably going to be doing most leaders in the game in one hit. Addicted to Power. This is a Serge. So this is one people have talked about quite a lot. This is a great combination card that works well with Zarcha. We mentioned Zarcha takes backlash damage if she fails to cast a spell at all. She doesn't cast. Addicted to Power for two glory. If you suffer backlash and survive, gain two glory. Well, that's great because she's probably going to backlash. Now, it is a card which you get rewarded for failing, which is an odd mindset to get to in a Warhammer in the world. But it's definitely worth thinking about because chances are if she does fail, you'll be upset about it. But you'd be less upset with two glory tokens. Mm-hmm. There's a card called Winged Death, which I love. I think this is perfect for these guys. It's a Surge hybrid, so you've got to do one of two things. Either kill enemy with range 3+ attack. So that's either Zarch's Spike Tongue Curse or the Hellfire Sword we saw earlier on. Or make a charge of 6 hexes, which we've already seen as the Conqueror's Cloak. There's other gambits we're going to talk about in a second. We can do it. So kill an enemy from range or make a charge of 6 hexes. If you do either of those, you get glory. Well worth doing. And Savage Exemplar is a Surge objective. Your leader kills anyone for one glory. Great. Perfect. Okay, so that's what you want to be going for. Now, I don't think you're going to be boosting your entire deck towards just aggro, but if you want to play aggro, that's a way of doing it. Let's have a look at Gambit Ploys. Universal Gambit Ploys, if you want to hit people on the head with axes. We've talked a little bit before about them, but Nightmare in the Shadows, Distraction, Sidestep. Any cards where you are Moving yourself towards the enemy, these are push cards, or moving the enemy towards you, great. If you can close that distance and hit them on the head with your big axe sooner, the better. You can also use Nightmare in the Shadows distraction to move people off objectives as well, which will really irritate them when they're trying to capture them. Spectral Wings, what a great card it has been since Nightvault. Plus two movement on next activation, a wonderful card. So that's one of your Chaos Warriors charging five or maybe six hexes across the battlefield, and nobody expects that. If you can stay four hexes away from Khagra, you're okay, right? But not if you get Spectral Wings off. And then there's a card called Blood Scent, which I love as well. Plus two dice to attack if target is wounded, so perfect for finishing off big wound models. So plus two dice to your attack action if the target is wounded. That is, I mean, imagine what we talked about before. You've hit one of the Stormcasters on the head, you've hit Fekir on the head for three damage, and you want to make sure you finish her off with Zasha. Yep, plus two dice on the spell attack action or any attack action to make it really make sure it happens. So it's, that's a really, really good card, that one. Upgrades we'll be looking at, great speed, great strength, great fortitude. As always, they're always there. Makes you faster, stronger, tougher. There's a card called Shade Glass Band. Every time you roll a critical in attack, place a potency counter on a card and then reroll one dice for the rest of the game in attack and defense, every potency card. Great. Every time you roll a crit, makes your attacks next time more reliable. Both good on Khagra, and on Zasha as well. I've got a dream combo I came up. This is one of my late night dream combos, Wade. If you can get Savage Strength off, right? Now, it makes you plus one damage at all times and makes you a hunter, which is perfect, right? Minus one defense, that's not so great. But plus one damage to your attacks and minus one defense. So minus one, I'm thinking of Khagra here, right? So if she's not inspired, she already starts on one defense and to a minimum of one, so she can't go down. So she just gets plus one damage and becomes a hunter. And then you get the trophy hunter upgrade as well, which means every kill is worth two glory apiece. And that's the dream, if you can do it. Let me know if you're someone out there that does it. And, of course, Larval Lance has been there since Beast Grave and is a wonderful card. It's a range two lance that does damage based on the turn number. Turn one, one damage, and one dice. Turn two, so forth. Turn three, you range three with a damage three lance. Great. That's what you want. So there we go. If you want to go aggressive, that's what we'll be going for, I reckon. That sounds more like up your street, Wade, that one.
Yeah, that seems like it's got an inbuilt security net if the wizard happens to die. Also hitting things hard with axes, which is definitely my preferred playstyle of any sort of Warhammer game. I know you've got some thoughts on how you can make best use of the desecration mechanic as well, because that's pretty much leaning into how Khagra's Ravagers are probably intended to be played rather than...
Well, I think the perfect combo here is because remember, to get desecration off at all, you've got to kill stuff. So if you tool your warband up to kill stuff with the knowledge that you're also going to desecrate objectives and stop enemies holding objectives as well, perfect. Also, if you come up against a warband that doesn't care about objectives, you need to have the aggressive thing there to score your glory as well. But let's have a look at some of the cards you want to be looking at if you are looking at the more desecration-y control side of the game. I've written here, let's really muck up the day of anyone trying to hold objective tokens. Great, right? We've all played that person who's like, I'm going to stay at the back and do nothing at all. I was that person in Shadespire. Don't judge me. So faction cards here, have a look at. So again, these are cards that are specific to Khagra's Ravagers. Raised Realm is an end phase card. Two or more desecration tokens on the board for two glory. Now, the end phase is quite difficult to do because, of course, you will have been through the power steps at that point. So the enemy is going to have all the chances they can to get them off. But if you can somehow in the last power phase or just the last turn before of the action phase, you can get those two desecration tokens on the board and they're still there in the end phase, you've got two glory. Now, this is another thing for psychological here as well, Wade, because every player playing against Khagra's Ravagers is going to know that they might well have Raised Realm in their hand. So maybe they're going to be like, I've got to get rid of those desecration tokens because I just need to, even though they have no effect on me. I'm an aggro warband. I'm playing Garrick's Reavers. I don't care about the objectives, but I've got to get rid of the tokens to stop them drawing glory. We talked about Ritual Desecration before, which is to pick an objective in the same hex and Inspire to Inspired. Wonderful card. And we talked about Mask of Darkness as well before, which is where you move your fighters around. I've moved on to a different thing. I've gone too far. Let's have a look at other faction objective cards. Desolate Domain, Surge, all objectives in one territory have desecration tokens. All objectives in one territory have desecration tokens. Now, you might think that's impossible because you're going to have to go for three or two. Well, imagine if you deploy only one objective in your territory, which, yeah, you're right. You're probably going to have four objectives in the enemy territory, which might be good for them if they're caring about objectives. If you're playing against an aggro warband, just place one objective in your territory. And it's also territory, not board as well, so no man's land doesn't count there. So just place one objective in your territory, desecrate that, instant glory, lovely. And then brutal desecration, which is an instant surge again, one gloryful, desecrating an objective. That's going to be in every single deck for these guys, because if you just get one desecration token down on any objective, you get instant glory. Lovely. So the gambit ploys for the more control minded player. Wrap the land, pick an objective token with one hex and desecrate it. Brilliant. So you pick an objective token within a hex of you, desecrate it. If you've been pushed off an objective and they just clear the objective token, desecrate it again. Go on then. Ritual desecration, we've talked about before. That's the one we talked about, which is great. Inspire a fire to desecrate an objective. And Mask of Darkness is perfect too. I think something to hear, it's important to point out that consider aggro cards. You need to make sure your deck is balanced with gambit ploys. You need to make sure you're getting in there to hit people with axes and at the same time backing up stuff to help desecrate tokens too. For an upgrade, one upgrade that's faction specific, I think is brilliant for these guys, is Grudging Defense. Fighter is on guard. Now, there's quite a few ploys and upgrades where fighter is on guard is a thing. But not only does it mean you get to have both the dodge and the shield result on the block dice when you're defending, but also means you can't be pushed back. That's super important if you're still on objective. If Dower Kraken's just stood on objective and despoiled it and got the desecration token down, you can't be pushed back. So it's less easy to clear them off. Right, universal cards here for these guys. A few I've picked out that are great for the control side of the game. Treasure Hunter, it's a great objective here. End phase, he holds two objectives in enemy territory for three glory. Three glory for holding two objectives in enemy territory. Again, it would really make you think about where you place those counters. Hold more objectives than the other warband for two glory, that's dominant position. If you hold one objective and the enemy holds none, you get this. But at the same time, if you just go and stand on objectives and defend them, then you get glory for that too. Path to Victory is a duel, which means you need to do two things. If in an end phase, if in the last action phase you killed an enemy fighter and you hold two objectives, it's two glory. Chances are you're probably going to do that in one phase. Plant a Standard, your leader holds an objective in enemy territory. Great card for one glory. Change of Fortunes, Surge feature token is flipped while friendly fighter is on it. Now, there's quite a few things you can do to flip tokens around. Part of the thing about ruining people's days if they're trying to play objective tokens is if you just flip those objective tokens over, they can't catch them anymore. But you can't get desecration tokens on them anymore, which may affect some of your objectives. But they can't use them anymore at all, which is, if you're playing against the Grimwatch, you're doing that. And Leave Nothing to Chance is another great card. Pick a feature token in a hex that contains a friendly fighter. Moved on to something different there. I moved on to... And Guardians of the Way. There we go. That's the last one there. Is another objective here. End phase, duel. You hold one objective and the enemy holds none for a glory, which is... You could do that in the first end phase, no problems at all. Gambit Ploys. Dangerous Prize, is wonderful for this warband if you're trying to play against objective fighters. Pick one objective token. First fighter to move onto it takes damage. So imagine this. You take an enemy fighter out of an objective marker. You put desecration token down the objective marker. Enemy desperately wants to clear that objective marker of the desecration token, but you play Dangerous Prize. If they do, they take a damage. It becomes a lethal hex briefly. Great, might make them think about whether they're going to or not, especially if you're playing a four wound warband. You don't want to take one damage ever, because then Khagra's got an easy kill. Unexpected Peril, pick a feature token in your territory and flip it. Well, okay, I'll do that. No problems at all. Pick a feature token in your territory, the whole board, not within range, just your territory, flip it. What a card. Leave Nothing to Chance, pick a feature token in the hex that contains a friendly fighter and remove the feature token. So you can... You despoil an objective, or if you think they're just going to come and take you off it, just get rid of that objective token off the game, out of the game. Also, remember, flipping objective tokens and removing them from the game really helps you score things where you're trying to desecrate all the objectives in one territory, for example, or hold all the objectives in one territory. And there's one upgrade which I really like, which is the universal upgrade here, Shard Caller. Again, been in the game since Shadespire. You can pick an object in each start of each action phase, so you only have to do it twice in the game at the most. You can pick one objective held by this fighter and swap it with another one. So imagine Zasha's at the back, stood on an objective. She's at someone and has got a desecration token, or use one of the gambit ploys to get a desecration token. where you swap that objective with someone else, somewhere, any objective token anywhere on the board, and the desecration token goes with it, which is great. Also good for Dao, Kraken, and Razek, who can despoil one objective, move it over there, and then get another one to despoil without having to move as well. It's a brilliant card. I've written, wow, I need this now, next to the Geomancer's Gauntlet. Again, it's a new upgrade card. It gives you, as an upgrade, it gives you an action option to flip all feature tokens within a hex. What? So good. It doesn't give you a token either. You can just continuously do it. So an action, just walk up to an objective and go, it's gone, flipped. So good. I need this in my life. But I do think we've gone through quite a few cards that are great for aggressive. We've gone through cards that are great for controlling. I think the combination is the one. You need if you want to really upset people's days, the objective controlling is going to be how you do it. But at the same time, you've got to get the kills in with the sacrifice rule in order to do it. So a combo of the two will be great. I think if you can just go all aggro if you want to and not worry about desecration, that will work against all warbands, whereas upsetting people's objective play will only work against objective warbands. But I think if you come up against an objective warband like the Grimwatch, and you know they'll already be worrying about the fact that they're not going to get to score very many objectives.
And if you're playing against Khagra's Ravagers, if you see them deploying on the other side of the board from you, you're not necessarily know how they're going to play. You know now that they've got quite a few tricks available to them, but you're not entirely sure which way that particular warband's going to go on the day until they pray to the dark gods and unleash them upon you.
Which is why, in some events, Wade, you'll see some events are best of three games, the typical Grand Clash games, whereas smaller games, Skirmish Matters, for example, are best of one games. In a best of three game, you'll have a chance, you'll find out what they do, what kind of warband they are in the first game, you'll have a chance to react to it in the second game. If it's a best of one game, you're only playing if it's a skirmish. Good luck. You got to think about what you're going to do. Are you going to defend against an aggressive warband, or are you going to try and move forward and take the objectives? Which one are they going to do? And that makes that's so unique in the game for doing this, that it's really a denial warband for some of the most powerful warbands in the game right now, which is nice. It slots nicely into the meta of the game.
Mm. Great stuff. And as is the case with new Warhammer Underworlds warbands, there are also some new cards that you might make use of in your other warbands. It might shake the existing gameplay up elsewise. What's caught your eye that might make it into some of your other Warhammer
Worlds? Yeah, absolutely. With every warband that comes out, Wade, you're right. Every warband contains a universal objectives, upgrades, and gambit ploys and spells that anybody can use. And this is no exception, this expansion. So let's have a look through some of the ones. Now, there's some great cards in here. But I've picked out my top picks for things you can't leave home with if you have a certain warband. There's a card in here called The Hunt Advances. This is a dual objective. Score this in an end phase if two things happen. Firstly, there are three or more friendly fighters in enemy territory. Okay, and each friendly fighter in enemy territory is a hunter. Well, if you've got Ripper Snarlfangs, who are all movement lots, and they're all hunters, and you can get them into enemy territory straight away, instant glory. It's an auto take for Ripper Snarlfangs. Other warbands as well that have hunters in two can do them too, but not many warbands have three very fast moving hunters. They're perfect for them. I'd say it's an auto take for them. There's a card called Unassailable again, which is another objective card. It's a hybrid here, so you can do one of two things: either score an end phase if either your leader is the only surviving leader, or you have the primacy token. Well, Molog, isn't it? Molog is going to kill the enemy leader, and he's also big and strong enough with lots of upgrades that he's going to be killing people in one hit from full wounds to no wounds. So the primacy token will be his. He's got to hold on to it till the end phase, but if you do, it's worth extra glory. That's great. God bless Molog, bless him. In the gambit ploys, we've got a great card called Beast Trail. Choose one friendly hunter or quarry with no move or charge tokens that is on an edge hex. Place that fighter in another edge hex and give that fighter a move token. Well, Hrothgorn's Mantrappers. Hrothgorn himself is a hunter, right? So if you deploy him in a starting hex, which is on the edge, and you have this in your hand at the start, play it straight away. He zips over to the other side of the board, anywhere he likes on an edge hex, and has a move token. So he can't move again, but he can start shooting with his big old crossbow, and then next turn moves him straight away. That is a devastating card for Hrothgorn. Good news. Upgrades-wise, there's one for Stormstar, which I love here. called the Rod of the Archmage. It's an upgrade here, and it gives you a reaction. After this fighter's gambit spell or a spell attack action that takes one or more enemy fighters out of action, gain the primacy token. Okay, no props. So your fulmination spell for Stormsire is 2 damage when he inspires. So you're not going to be killing too many big fighters, but if you get the combos off with Storm's Fury or Tempest's Might to increase the damage of your spells, then you'll be getting people killed quite easily. But also, you'll notice it's basically gain the primacy token for killing anyone at all with a spell attack action or an attack action that may have been wounded to start with. So you can get away with only doing 2 damage 2 or damage 3 attacks and still getting big kills and gain the primacy token for extra glory. Lovely. And, oh man, there's one at the end here as well, Wade. I love this upgrade called Scavenged Armor. You cannot give this upgrade to a fighter in your territory. Okay, no problem. So this is basically going on a super aggressive warband. When you give this upgrade to a fighter, give that fighter a guard token and plus one wound. Sure. So it's like super duper great fortitude. So you not only get to get plus one wound, imagine Morgok with 6 wounds. Whew. And on guard as well. So hopefully he loses that when he charges, which he will do almost immediately. But yeah, great. I also thought Rippers it'll work on, Magors it'll work on, anyone hitty, so they can just, you know, stand there and take a hit and then run in and smash someone's face in. Great stuff.
I love the idea of all the destruction warbands looting their way through the extra good stuff in this set of code. Oh, Hrothgorn's having this, Molog takes this, Rippers run off with this. Yeah, Horse of Destruction having a great time. Class, and some thoughts on the wider gaming experience. How do you think Khagra's Ravagers will typically fare against other warbands in the game? Are there warbands they should look out for, and warbands they should lick their chops at the thought of?
Well, like anything, Wade, I think these guys, you'll need to see them on the table and experience it yourself. Obviously, with the world as it is at the moment, we've not seen them on the table very much, and also they've not been released at this point in time talking, so definitely haven't seen them very much. But I have a sneaky feeling they're going to absolutely lap up any game where you sit down at the table and you realize your opponent's got the Sepulchral Guard or Zarbag's Gits or Thorns of the Briar Queen. You're like, oh, lots of easy kills. Fantastic. They'll lap those up and get all the desecration tokens they want, especially if that warband's trying to hold it. The ideal way is the Sepulchral Guard and Zarbag's Gits, both warbands who can get big glory off scoring objectives and are dead easy to kill with damage to attacks, which is how the warband is made up. They'll love those. Also, the Grimwatch. They'll have fun against the Grimwatch because Duke Krakmo and his chums are going to have to really change how they play the game. Lots of really easy to kill warriors in that warband who are trying to hold objectives. And yeah, good on them. I reckon they'll struggle against full on aggro warbands. So we talked a little bit about how aggro warbands probably ignore objective tokens anyway and don't care. But they'll struggle. Yeah, they'll struggle, I reckon, against other 4 wound warbands as damage output is only average. Trying to get everyone in the warband up to doing 4 wound or 4 damage is difficult to do. Khagra more easy to do, but I reckon they'll struggle. I think their worst matchup in my mind will probably be like something like Morgok's Crushers, who just don't care about the objectives. At the same time, though, like I said before, if you're flying desecration tokens around, Morgok's Crushers have got to do something about it. But at the same time, there's only 3 fighters in that warband, and they're very hard to kill. So getting a desecration token down at the same time is going to be difficult. So I reckon they might be their rock, paper, scissors. But okay, again, see them on the table to find out.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm not asking you to make an absolute commitment or a pledge for the future. Just some early thoughts from how you looked at the game in isolation. Now, have you painted all of the warbands that have been released as part of Direchasm so far?
You're making me admit publicly I have not. No, I'm all but one. My Morgoth's Blade Coven still remain unpainted. They're my next project. Close.
For this particular season, since the Direchasm release, you painted the Dread Pageant and Maiari's Pyramid.
In that case, Wade, yes, 100% of all the warbands for this season. I've painted all 3, which seems quite cool.
And is this a very different, sounds like a very different gaming experience to what we've seen introduced with those first 2 new warbands of the new season and throwing in, little cat amongst the pigeons for Warhammer Underworld style with this new warband?
It's not just for the season, Wade. It's a unique warband for the whole game, which is a really interesting way of playing. Normally, warbands have one trick, and they're really good at that one trick. You know, if you're playing Magors or Magoks, you're hitting people on the head with a big axe. If you're playing Sepulchral Guard, you're gaining those objectives and you're coming and you're raising people back to life. These guys do 2 different things, and they do them very well. And if they do them both in connection with each other, they're going to go really, really well. But if you fail on either side, if you don't get those kills, you can't do the other thing. If you don't get the desecration tokens, you might be overrun by larger modeled objective holding warband. So it's a toughie. But I don't, they've got a nice place in the, it's nice that the game designers are coming up each time with new mechanics that makes each warband really unique. So hats off to Dave and John and all those guys who are doing a great job.
Absolutely. And I was checking out the articles that are up on Warhammer Community, indeed chatting to Dave and having a look at the cards and letting people get a good insight into what Khagra's Ravagers will offer. And also the wonderful assembly and painting videos that you've put together. So I now know that you have painted Khagra's Ravagers as you see them on the box, on the back of the box, to be emulated by people at home. And you've also painted a set of your own, haven't you? You've painted two sets of Khagra's Ravagers. Yeah. I've even seen sight of them myself.
I got excited, Wade. I've dedicated this week to the Dark Gods, apparently. I have to get back to being a good Ultramarine soon. But yeah, I've definitely painted, did the video for Khagra's Ravagers, which is cool. You can see that now on Warhammer TV, and you can see how to paint the miniatures as you see on the box. They've got like a really nice black armor color and red cloaks and that sort of thing. They're really cool in that way, sort of undivided classic color scheme. I've painted mine as sort of like a brass color scheme. We used Rune Lord Brass as a base coat. Actually, very similar color scheme to how the new Necron Dynasty is painted, so Runal Brass and Cryptocarmache Gloss and Kinetic Ally being used are fantastic colours, and really harks back to some of the sort of classic Chaos Warriors of olden days of brass armour. They're not, I've used like black as an accent colour because they're very close. They could be quite corny, couldn't they, if I used red, but I've used black and accent colour to make sure they look very, in fact, thinking about it, they look a lot like the Black Legion Chaos Space Marines from 140,000, so that's sort of undivided look. I just thought they look quite cool like that. So yeah, they're done. So I can't wait. I cannot wait, Wade, to get them on the table and desecrate some objectives.
Well, we may have to check in on you and see if your predictions were the lies of demons or a true vision from the Chaos Gods as Khagra's Ravagers to spoil all before you. Well, thank you for taking the time. That is a wonderfully in-depth exploration of what is in the Khagra's Ravagers expansion, Nick. That's awesome. Thank you very much.
Thank you, man. Thanks for having me.
No worries. And we'll see you again for another episode of the Warhammer Community Podcast next time. Cheers.